Funny. The Loud Spot podcast uses adult humor and adult language in its broadcast. It may be unsuitable for younger audiences. Viewer discretion is advised. Also, we are idiots. Please don't take anything we say offensive or to heart.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to Loud Spot. We got a great show for you guys tonight. On the second half of the show, we do have a band called Unveil The Strength. Hopefully they come on. We got it with Matt Snell, who was the original bass player from a band called Five Finger Death Punch. Who everyone that listens to this show probably knows who Five Finger Death Punch is. This show is brought to you by this particular episode by Inked Nation, a tattoo convention that Don and myself are throwing. Sam's now involved. It's going to be here in Oklahoma City. What Sam?
I was going to say you that I was forced into. No, just kidding.
February 23rd through 25th, downtown OKC. Sam, play that clip before we get into our next segment.
That's not crazy that Taylor Swift put that guy Travis Kelce on the map. He literally blew up now.
What are you talking about?
That guy Travis Kelce that's dating Taylor Swift. She blew him up.
She blew him up? What does that even mean?
Like, no one knew who he was before.
What? You're kidding me, right?
No.
You're kidding?
No. Him and his friend, Mahomes, that waved to her.
Oh my God. Like, Patrick literally... Mahomes? I get you don't understand how the world works, but Travis Kelce and Patrick Mahomes are probably the best quarterback tight end duo in the history of football.
But no one knew who they were until Taylor Swift went to their game.
In your world, no one knew who they were. He won 2 Super Bowls, and he is literally going to be in the Hall of Fame for being one of the best tight ends ever played his game.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, until Taylor Swift, no one knew who they were.
Jane, I can't even talk to you anymore.
So that is apparently a trend that is on TikTok.
Yeah. I've seen a lot of them videos, and a lot of them I can tell that the wives are messing with them because they're actual football watchers. But that one right there, that woman, she does not look like she watches football a day in her life. And I would actually think that she sincerely thinks that Taylor Swift, you know, made him popular for that game, which is... Yeah.
No, I don't think she sincerely thought that. I think it
was seriously zoned out. You saw that. She just
all acting.
She's not acting. Okay.
Yeah. It's all TikTok acting.
It's a trend people are doing.
I've seen a lot of them, and you can tell that the wives are messing with them because you can hear them laugh. But the best one I seen was actually this black man, and he was doing something in his yard, and he got irate, and she's snickering because she of course watches football with him, you know, and it's later said that, but boy howdy, he got mad as a hornet.
Boy howdy.
Boy, where the heck did that come? Boy, howdy did she get mad? Yeah, you know,
are you from the South or something?
You would think. I'm born and raised in Oklahoma. I get made fun of no matter where I live on how I talk. Who knows? Yep. I'm just different.
The problem I have with this whole ordeal is that my gut tells me PR stunt, right? My gut tells me that this is a whole PR stunt because we all know that she's a big Philadelphia Eagles fan. Big.
Not anymore. She's not, dude. You think it's a PR stunt when they're smashing?
She converted.
You know how many people smash when they're doing PR stunts? Sebastian, you know how many people smash when they're doing PR stunts? Like almost all of them.
I know.
Here's the conspiracy theory that Travis Kelce and Taylor Swift's PR teams have got together. They said, okay, he's got to pick 3 games. He's got to pick 3 games. He's got to sit out because of a knee injury. We'll call it a knee injury. And one of those being a playoff game, and the other one being if they make it to the Super Bowl and face Philadelphia Eagles again. Because who's a 3-0 team right now? I'm just saying.
Not the Chiefs. Not,
not no, the Chiefs. Philadelphia Eagles.
Yeah, I know. That's why I said not the Chiefs.
Yeah, well, the Chiefs can bounce back. Look at their division, so.
Yeah, no, I know. I'm just, I don't think it's a PR stunt. I will say this, though.
PR stunt.
I will say this. Travis Kelce did gain a 21% boost on his Instagram. It was about 550,000.
He got all those big.
Now here's the thing, though.
He's 400% increase in jersey sales.
Okay. Okay. So here's the deal is Taylor Swift fans might now become Chiefs fans. Okay. But I don't think any Chiefs fans have been converted to Taylor's, maybe a couple, but I, like the players on the team, maybe that got to meet her now, but I don't, in the grand scheme, I don't think Taylor Swift gained any new followers. Like, no, it just benefits him. It just benefits Travis Kelce. Yeah.
If he breaks her heart,
I feel sorry for that song coming out.
That song is going to be number one, right? Because if you think about it, when is the Grammys?
At
the end of January. At the end of January. So it's so gonna be
okay. So if it is a PR stunt, we will find out
by January.
By January, because then they break up. She has a new song, new hit. It's about Travis Kelce. That, not going to say his name of the song.
But she's
got to
release it in December, otherwise it can't be counted for.
Right. So they're going to break up early December, end of November. Enough time for her to get a song, put it out there, and release it to the world.
That's right. And then he plays the Super Bowl and they lose because he's heartbroken on top of that.
Dude, if they break up and then his game starts suffering from heartache and his stress because of Taylor Swift, Chiefs fans are not going to like her anymore.
Travis Kelce has been a player in this game for a long time as far as like with the ladies. We'll put it that way. He's dated some very notable ladies in this in the music industry and in the acting industry. So I don't think it's going to matter whether she breaks up with him or not. There's a part of me. Okay, so I laugh internally.
But this is blown up way bigger, though. Go ahead.
Okay, yeah, but it is. I laugh internally because how do we say this in nice terms on the radio? She looks like a very boring person in the bedroom activities.
You would go there.
You don't think Taylor Swift does the anal?
You think she's vanilla?
She's very vanilla. I think she's missionary, vanilla, and then, you know, doesn't vocalize anything in the bedroom. So that's just me. Personally, I know that's not necessarily true. I don't know if any of this is true, but
you don't know.
She may have the innocent look and, you know, just be a real big freak. You never know.
That's right. She just might be. Uh-huh. I doubt it.
Not all women who look innocent are vanilla.
I think her mom has to sign off on every bedroom activity before she does anything.
Let's go into Blink-182's. They have a new song out called One More Time. Let's jam that right now, right here on the Loud Spot.
Strangers, from strangers into brothers, from brothers into strangers once again. We saw the whole world, but I couldn't see the meaning. I couldn't even recognize my friends. Older, but nothing's any different. Right now feels the same, I wonder why. I wish they told us it shouldn't take a sickness or airplanes falling out the sky. Do I have to die to hear you miss me? Do I have to die to hear you say goodbye? I don't want to act like there's tomorrow. I don't want to wait to do this one more time. One more time. One more. One more time. One more time. I miss you. Took time, but I admit it. It still hurts even after all these years. And And I know that next time ain't always gonna happen. I gotta say I love you while we're here. Do I have to die to hear you miss me? Do I have to die to hear you say goodbye? I don't wanna act like there's tomorrow. I don't wanna wait to do this one more time. One more time. One more. One more time. One more time. One more time. One more time. One more. One more time. One more time. One more time. I miss you.
All right, guys, let you know, on this show we normally talk rock music and rock news and other topics. We don't really get into hip-hop too much, but I did find it interesting that Eminem, he's been rapping for 30 years. That's three decades of Eminem. It's been that long.
It's making me feel old.
Well, if you look at the top charting music acts of all time, this is going across all genres of music: rock, country, hip hop, everything. Okay, blues, whatever, polka. That's a genre. That's a genre. Eminem hit just knocked out Led Zeppelin in the top 10 spot of best selling artist of all time. So Led Zeppelin was there. Now Eminem is sitting there, and he has 207 million plus. And this is between streams, albums, singles across all countries. It takes that long. Somebody was saying, you know, well, Jelly Roll's probably right behind him. I'm like, I doubt Jelly Roll's even in the top 100, because it takes a long time to build and sell that many albums. That's insane.
But out of all the people that are going right now, I have to say that Jelly Roll might actually be the one.
Oh, you're the one, huh? You're the one over here with Jelly Roll. No,
I'm just saying I could see him staying around for 30 years, just like Eminem, and staying relevant because he is just that popular right now. And that's how Eminem
died of a heart attack.
Well, but that's how Eminem was whenever he came out. I mean, he just skyrocketed and he just stayed up there that whole time. And, you know, nobody knows the future.
I know you're a big Jelly Roll fan. Here's
why I don't think Jelly Roll will ever hit that status.
No one asked you.
Okay.
I was trying to.
I don't care. Go ahead. I'll tell you why I don't think he'll ever hit that status.
All right, hold on. Here's the deal with Jelly Roll. Jelly Roll is the flavor of the month right now, and if he, as long as he can keep, you know, going across from rap, hip hop to country and back and forth, he'll be okay. But the actual thing about the shelf life of all artists these days after 2010 is very, very nil. Like, other than anyone before 2010, yes, but anyone after 2010, no. I'm sorry, I just don't see Jelly Roll. But and Eminem, as long as he comes out with more music, if he doesn't come out with more music, he'll be surpassed too, just like Michael Jackson did, just like everyone else did.
You know, actually, Michael Jackson, I got news on him as well that follows this. So I think you're actually wrong, Sam, and it's actually factually you're wrong. But I will say this, though, about Jelly Roll and why I don't think he'll ever hit the top 10. And it's only, and for my reason only, thinking Eminem got famous when he was in his 20s, okay?
Right.
Jelly Roll is, what, 40?
Yeah, he's our age.
So that means 30 years, he's going to be 70. I don't think people are going to be listening to him like they do Eminem, because Eminem is still relevant today at 50. In 10 years, Jelly Roll is going to be 50. So, and Eminem, and there's no way Jelly Roll is even bigger than Eminem was.
Oh, he is bigger. He is bigger.
Jelly Roll is?
Yeah, bigger.
He's talking big.
Physically. So, back to your thing, Sam. We're going to get to the Michael Jackson thing, but there's only four rap artists that have hit the top 100 music acts of all time. There's four of them. Okay. Do you know who they are? One of them's obviously Eminem.
Right.
Okay. Do you know who the other three are?
Snoop Dogg.
No.
Snoop Dogg.
Dr. Dre.
No.
What?
Tupac. Yep.
I said Tupac first.
Tupac is probably the weakest of the other three, but he said
that he got killed.
84 million sales. 84 million sales is where Tupac's out there.
Which reminds me, they just finally put someone in jail for his murder. So
they did.
Yep, they just finally the guy
that
was riding.
They always thought.
Well,
the guy that was riding with them killed him.
Well, the other car. So he released a book and he's talked about being in the other car that shot them up. So, yeah, he boasted and got caught.
I guess he thought the statute of limitations was out for it.
No.
And he thought he was safe.
I don't think there's a statute of limitations for murder. I think murder is just.
It's just forever.
It's forever. You could 90 years later, if you're still alive, you're going to jail if they catch you.
All right. So we got Tupac. We have Eminem.
The other two, I'll just say it is Drake. It at 120 million sales. I know.
He's not rap. So
Drake's number 41. Eminem's 10. Drake's 41. Tupac's number 73. And at number 61 with 98 million sales is Kanye West.
Oh, my God.
I wouldn't think Drake or Kanye would be on the list, to be honest with you. I would not have thought that at all.
I mean, if you just take a credit card and buy 50 grand worth of worth of album sales every year, you could probably stay on the top with, I mean, Tekashi 6ix9ine showed us that. So
yeah. Is he even relevant anymore?
No, just for
and last time he got big, it's because he got jumped like in a bathroom somewhere, I think.
Yeah, in a gym. Yeah.
The gym. Yeah, the bathroom at the gym. Okay. Now, Sam, to go to your Michael Jackson thing. I have the top five best-selling music acts of all time. Okay.
All right.
Who do you think number one is?
Well, Michael Jackson, obviously.
No, it's not Michael Jackson. Prince. But I don't think he got surpassed either, though.
Remember, this is in the world.
It's not Prince. I don't know. I don't have number 6, 7, 8, or 9. All I have is 1 through 5 and then 10.
Right.
And then the other rap guys. Okay, so number one, which I'm not surprised by, is the Beatles.
Okay. Yeah.
Beatles at 388 million sales worldwide. Number two, though, is Michael Jackson.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
You know, it's so funny. And the reason why Michael Jackson still sells is because he is so big on the world scale. Like in other countries, he's still selling out. And it's like, he's dead, everybody. So you can keep listening to his music, but he's gone. And they're gonna keep buying.
I gotta correct myself because Beatles actually had 423 million. Michael Jackson's at 338 million. So that's a big difference in the millions, Yeah, number three, which I'm not surprised is in the top three, Elvis Presley.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay, with 279 million. Number four, I'm surprised by this, Queen.
Queen, huh?
Queen at 279 million sales, yeah. And then number five, it does not surprise me either. We're going to go with Madonna at number five.
Yeah. Well,
notice how it's not Jelly Roll, Don.
He's new.
He's been doing music for a long time, though.
Yeah,
he has.
He's new as far.
And
as
he was skinny whenever he first started. I do know that.
Was he? I didn't.
Yes.
Know.
He was.
Yes. I mean, yes.
He's probably doing a lot of drugs though. Then he quit doing the drugs and got all huge.
Look, at the end of the day,
he got happy. He met Bunny and got
Bunny. Jelly Roll or Bunny, if you're listening, or any of the management team, we love Jelly Roll here on this thing. We would love to have him on. He won't come on because he's so busy. We got it because I've already gotten the answer back from his PR team. Like, we're too busy. You're nobody. Go away. You know, kind of thing. Just kidding. But but we would love to have Jelly Roll. But the thing is we want something new out of him.
Release a new one.
No, I'm talking about the backstory, silly. Oh, okay. Not the music. We will get the music. The music, the music's gonna be there. But you know the backstory. You know, hopefully, is Bunny fertile? I don't think so. I think she's got all her parts taken out. So,
how do you know that? Is that what people talk about on the news?
Like, yeah.
How do you know? Are you sitting there Googling? Can Bunny Jelly Roll's wife get pregnant? Is that what you do late at night? Let's take a quick music break, and then we're going to get into Don's subject. We're going to talk Ozzy Osbourne. Let's go into Garzi featuring Kellin Quinn of Sleeping With Sirens. This song is called...
I got the shirt on.
This song's called Mess. Let's jam. Let's jam it right now. Oh, I've been trying not to go bad shit, but I'm losing my mind. Your love, nothing but a distraction. And I fall for your lies. Now I'm running through the city, gonna find out if I can take another shot or fucking die now. Panic, I'm a mess, now it slides out. And she just wanna have fun and never calm down. Oh, now you wanna come back like it. Oh, you never try to leave and stay. Oh, you just wanna rip another hole inside my heart and make me hate my life. This hurt, love fight, love never feel this way. Right now, we are joined a little early by Mark Wolf, who's in a band called Unveil The Strength. He's going to join us in conversation until Matt Snell comes on later on in the show, who's also with the band. But right now, Dawn has a topic that she wants to discuss about Ozzy Osbourne.
We're going to just let the viewers know who are listening to us in audio format. When Matt does come on, he's going to be called Mark Snell, and we're going to call Mark Wolf Matt Wolf. That way we're going to just keep messing with it. That way see if Matt gets mad at us. That, you know, that's what we're trying to do.
That's what we talked about backstage.
We're going to dine Mark out right here, right now. He's the one that brought this up. He wants him to be called. Well, he's not here yet, so...
Yeah, he is. He's right there.
Yeah, he is. He's right there. Son of a bitch. He's waving. He can hear us.
I didn't hear the thing. All right. Well, we might as well let Mark Snell in.
All right.
Mark Snell is here with Matt Wolf.
There you go.
On the podcast.
Well, I guess I'm not the only guy drinking right now, huh?
Well, we done messed it up.
Before we get to the interview with Unveil the Strength, let's go ahead and Dawn, take it away with your Ozzy Osbourne.
Yeah, I can't stop this laughing conversation because this ain't a laughing matter with Ozzy. I mean, I'm an 80s baby, so, you know, I'm a fan of Ozzy, but of course, everybody knows that he had that serious fall in 2019 on top of his Parkinson's, so he had to stop touring and everything, cancel shows that he already had booked for surgery, and he's actually not going out like that. He is going to go out the way he wants to, and that is performing, and they actually have him quoted, for 3 years, he half bought myself into the fact that my performance career was over. And then after he had his first surgery, he decided that he was going to start writing a new album. And he's about to have another surgery. And he says, no matter how that goes, he's still doing his writing.
If you think about it, his performance in general is him running, you know, back and forth on the stage. And he could do this from a chair. I mean,
because his last performance, he actually had to have somebody come out and stand next to him to hold him up because it was that bad of an injury. And plus Parkinson's, I mean, I don't know if you're familiar with it. I am because my grandfather had it. I mean, it's debilitating. And so it's very hard for you to even have the stamina to stand for any length of time.
I was getting to the point of he could be in a chair like freaking Foo Fighters.
Well, Ozzy could get away with it because, you know, I think people would still come and see him. Yeah, yeah.
He'd have to have a really cool throne. Do you think that a lot of these older guys, like Alice Cooper, is also going back on tour? He announced a 2023-2024 tour. He's like 75. What's that band that we talked about a few podcasts ago? The Rolling Stones. They're back doing. They're going to go on tour to promote their new song and album. Do you think that these older guys, you know, you hear midlife crisis, right? People have a midlife crisis. That's normally at the age of 40. there you go. Matt's waving his hand over there. Go, Matt, what's your opinion on this? Go ahead.
One does not talk ill of the Godfathers.
Oh, we're not okay. We're not talking ill, but
we're all here because of them.
That's true.
They can do as long as they can still perform to their best. God bless them. Let them do it.
But do you think though, going back to
we'll talk shit about anybody. Actually, we'll talk shit about anybody at the end of the day.
I don't think that it is a midlife crisis for Ozzy per se. I think it's because he sees everybody that was, you know, popular around his up and coming are still performing, and he kind of feels, you know, like taken down because his disease and everything, and he doesn't want to go out like that. He'd rather go out on stage singing, doing what he loves.
Keeps you going, plain and simple. Like if you stop, you stop. Like I'm never stopping. Like I already have my retirement plan. It's going to be Mark and I in like Oahu playing Jimmy Buffett covers in ugly.
Yeah, there you go.
And like we'll barely be able to pull it off. It'll be hysterical, and we'll be giggling about it. And everyone else was like, oh, that's such a great show. These guys are amazing. I'm like, yeah, you're fucking seven Mai Tais in. Like,
Sebastian, you got that next song loaded up by any chance?
I do. It is. We're going to get to the band interview right after this. Let's go ahead and play Sevendust. Their new song is called Superficial Drug.
Like myself for a while, it's so hard to move on. Why do I feel like I'm never around to see you explode? I used to be so much better when I didn't give a damn at all. Oh no, where you been?
All right, now we are officially joined by Mark Wolf and Matt Snell. I swear I almost said Mark Snell and Matt Wolf again for some reason. And you know, they're two M names that start with four letters, and even your last names both have five letters each.
So I know, it sounds like a confused girl leaving a La Quinta in the morning.
Just Eminem. We'll call him Eminem.
No comment, but I have seen a couple of those. The band is from, I thought you guys were from Texas, but according to the earlier conversations behind the scenes, I guess, Matt, you're over in the Lake Tahoe area. Is that right? Near there? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm in Reno. I'm as far out of Reno as you can get before you're in Tahoe.
Oh, right on, man. I was just in Shasta. That's kind of far. That's a little bit north. That's, or south. Is it north? No, it's south. Reno's north. Anyways, Matt Snell was the Matt was the original bass player from 2005 to 2010 for a band called Five Finger Death Punch, who everybody knows.
Yeah, I don't know who those guys are.
Have you never heard of them? Yeah. They're okay. They're all right. I live in
Vegas, but no one hears of those guys.
Actually, Sebastian's not a fan of Five Finger Death Punch.
He's not. He's actually
that
not.
Is true. That's one of the only bands I'm not a big fan of.
You have faith that isn't only in your mind.
Thanks for calling me out, Don. I was about to say it was my favorite band when you were in it, Matt. But in fact, I quit listening to them after you left the band. I was like, thank you. Yeah. If Matt's not in it, fuck them. I quit. I quit listening to them.
I'll buy
that's
that.
Not true. That's that's full of horse hockey. He's never listened to them. He barely listens to anybody.
And I don't know if Mark, okay, I'm sure Mark's in other bands also. I don't know. That was not included in my email that I got. No. Anything about Mark. So all my questions I have are for Matt. But you know what? We're going to switch it up. I'm good at ad-libbing things and making things up on the spot. So the band started in 2018. I'm going to start it. Maybe first album came out in 2018. Six songs released, I think, so far, and over 40 million streams on Spotify. That is absolutely crazy. Did you expect that kind of commercial success when the band first got together? That question goes to either one of you.
Yes.
Yeah, they paid for it. Come on.
Matt's confident.
No, we did not pay for it.
No, we don't do that at all. I actually, to be perfectly honest with you, I actually took a Joey Sturgis course on how to market your music through Spotify, where I literally create spreadsheets and send every curator an email to pitch a song. And I'll lock myself in my room for weeks at a time. It's kind of maddening, to be honest with you. And that's kind of how that happened. It just boom, 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 boom. But it's interesting that you bring up the point of buying, you know, listeners or buying spins. I mean,
it happens, yeah.
It's not an industry secret. Even the majors do it. Well, anyone that says that they don't is you're lying to yourself. And I always find it interesting that Spotify will ridicule or pick on the small guy that chooses to do it when all their major label artists are all doing the same damn thing. I'm just going to call it for what it is. We haven't done it. We don't. I don't have the money to pay anybody to play my music, bro. True. I'm too cheap to do that. So I'd rather pay money to Joey Sturgis and learn his course. And I can teach you guys if you want to learn it. I'm not selfish with that knowledge, but it was absolutely a lot of hard work. And
it took a long time. Like, that didn't happen overnight. Like, you're talking 2018 all the way into the pandemic, and we're in 23, and now we got those spins. That stuff started a long time ago, just no one was paying attention.
Yeah,
you know, walk quietly, carry a big stick. That goes a long way.
Yeah, we had a little 2-year pause in there that kind of made us go, okay, should we release music? And a lot of bands chose to write. And so we were in the middle of releasing, and we chose to maybe let's just hold off a little bit and see how this plays out.
And, but wouldn't releasing music during the pandemic make more sense because people are at home listening to music?
You would think so, but every single thing that occupied that period of time was fear-based media about what's going to happen to your life if this thing happens next. It wasn't music. Nobody cared. We were watching bands release stuff that was like, dude, this is a great record. And they would release it and like it would fall on its face. And we were just kind of like, whoa. It was kind of shocking for us a little bit. It made us do some reevaluation. And in some ways, I'm glad we did. I'm kind of glad we did. I almost wish we would have pumped out. We did pump out a couple of songs. We did start writing a couple songs then. But if I knew it was going to last that long, I probably would have wrote a couple of records during that period of time.
So you mentioned this, the Joey Sturgis course, okay? And people that pay versus people that, don't pay, like you guys are not paying, and how Spotify, you know, they don't want, they frown on that. And the little guys, they kind of attack more than the big guys. But are the little guys doing it in a way to where it's more bots doing it than maybe professionals putting it out there? Is there a difference?
I don't know. That question's so far above my pay grade. I can't answer that.
What's more important is it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how they're cheating the system. When they go to do a show, we all know.
Yeah. I mean, here's the reality of Spotify. You
know that whole story about the guy who made the fake band, and all of a sudden he had all this stuff and all these guarantees, and then nobody came because it was cool. At the end of the day, like, if your music isn't good enough, it's not good enough. You can spend, I know horrible bands that have huge budgets and no one's buying it. They keep shoveling it out there. They're always on a tour. They always got merch. They always have transportation. They got everything they need, but no one's buying it. You have to have a decent product, which is where we started, with a decent product. So when we worked with Spotify, which is what I did before, I worked with radio stations. You know, you work with them. You don't buy them. You say, how do I advertise with you? How do I work with you? They will curate playlists and put us on them. We can find out that we're on 4,600 playlists. Like,
I think right now we're on.
I don't have time for that. Like, they did that because we curated correctly.
So the last time I checked, we're on 4,844 or 46 playlists, and that was just really by people.
I don't even know if that's a big number on Spotify. Maybe that's an average number. I don't know.
That's big to me. I don't know.
I don't know.
I just know that we've money. I got a ton of it.
We've done all of these. We've done some numbers, and the only I think we were on one official Spotify playlist. One.
And yeah, the rest is, like, people putting them on.
The rest are just people that are like, "Wow, I really like your band, and I want to put you on a playlist." And like, to me, that really speaks more volumes than anything else, because
most definitely,
I know that there's people out there that can call industry people and get people on multiple playlists like that right now. I know that. That is a fact. If you know the right people, they'll get you on Spotify playlists like nothing. But for me, it tells me that we're doing something right if the people are believing in the music and the people are putting it on their playlists, and they enjoy listening to it when they work out. They enjoy listening to it when they go to their gym. They enjoy listening to, you know, a song. Every time I make a new fan, I have this thing where I go on Instagram and I make 10 friends a day. I just friend request 10 friends a day on our page. And even yesterday, I had two people repost our stuff and go, "Oh my God, you guys covered End of Heartache by Killswitch Engage. And that is, dude, this song is freaking amazing." And they just instantly go and started reposting on our stories. I had no idea that was going to happen. And just making those connections with the people on a fundamental root-based level, grassroots sort of level, I think is more sustaining, in my opinion, for the long game. Because you have to ask yourself, you can play the short game and pay a bunch of money and kind of buy your way in, and that may or may not work for you. There's a million ways to do something that we consider successful in the music industry. But I think things start with, you know, a great song. And I think it starts with really being passionate about what you're doing and believing it, and having songs where people feel you. I'm not going to tell you I'm the best vocalist or I can hit the highest note or do that, but I've been told many times, they're like, "Man, I really felt this song." And yeah, to me, that's really what I strive for. I want to convey an emotion. If I want to invoke you to have an emotion that maybe triggered a trauma or a memory or a healing process for you. And to me, that is success. Those are the emails. Those are the conversations I love having. I don't really give a fuck about numbers, to be honest with you.
You know what? I like where your head's at. I mean, your input and your thought process on it is spot on. I wish most musicians had that same mental process about what they're doing. So kudos to you, man. That's awesome. Yeah.
Definitely.
Thanks for coming to my TED Talk.
A little long-winded, damn it.
Sam, I know you had a
I have nothing. I have nothing.
Okay.
I actually do. I actually, my question was for Matt, just because I am a tattoo artist. So I have to ask you, you took a, what was it? A 5-year break between Five Finger and Unveil the Strength. Did you actually focus? No, you didn't. Not from 2013 to 2018.
I put out 2 records and one of them got signed to a major deal and toured it into the ground.
Okay. Well, I couldn't figure out what you were doing for those 5 years. And that's why I figured I'd ask if you were focusing on your tattoo career just as an in-between, or if that's just kind of like a backup thing.
The tattoo thing came at the trail end of NVIDIA when I was touring NVIDIA. It was a band I did with some cats in Vegas. And that it was very clear, you know, by the blood spatter on the wall, the band's going nowhere. And that's when I hooked up with Mark, actually. And I had him come out to a show. And it was more just to interview Mark and get to know him a little bit better and talk to him. Because every time we met was at NAMM and it was just chaos, you know. So we got he literally sang in his car for me. It was epic. He goes, "I can sing this shit, bro. Check it out." And then he just belted out like half the song. I'm like, "Yeah, you're good. Let's talk as soon as I get home." And then, you know, once COVID was coming and I opened the shop at the end of NVIDIA, beginning of Unveil the Strength, and I had somebody run it for me for a minute. But it was very evident that they didn't have the experience running companies that I had from my life before bands. And so I came in and started running the shop for about 2 years. And then my mentor looked at me, he goes, "If you're going to run a shop, you need to learn." So I said, "Okay." And I actually took an apprenticeship in my own shop for what turned out to be 18 months because of COVID. But like once COVID hit, we just sat around together and drew together and worked together and tattooed each other. And I learned more in that amount of, it would have taken me 3 years in a chair, you know, to become the artist I am now. And like, it's a never ending. It's the most stressful job I've ever had. Like being a rock star was easy. I would get up there and act like a maniac in front of 70,000 people, but they're drunk and not really paying attention to the bass player. Right. So I make a mistake. It's kind of like, whatever. Now, if I mess up your tattoo, I get a picture text message, and, you know, like, "Hey, I don't think this line on this petal is right." You know, and you go home and you look at your picture and self-doubt yourself. But it's that, you know, that same attitude of I want to be the best I can be. That came from music. That came from, I've never lost an audition ever. Like I always win because I prepare. It's the same thing. I draw all my tattoos out on Procreate before I even sit down. And I've done 1,000 butterflies, but yours is unique. So I'm going to make sure yours is something. So I'll take a minute and sketch it, you know, everything. You prepare. Yeah. Tattooing is a great way to like become a musician. You know, it's just the stakes are a little bit higher. Yeah.
I get lost with it.
It's funny that you mentioned, you know, a wrong line on a pedal, right? That actually, not even lying, I called Don on the line that was on a leaf next to a petal. And I was like, "Does that line look right to you?" And she was like, "Don't worry about it. We're fixing that whole thing anyway." She did this big cover up for me. She's like, "It's not a big deal."
But it's funny that he had a crap tattoo, and I was reworking it to bring it back to life. And we didn't make it through the whole session. And so, one little thing was poking out, which was not going to be there once I was done with it. But
and it's not there anymore.
OCD right there.
Your mistake. Yeah, it happens. We're humans. It happens. It's the worst thing in the world. And as soon as you do it, you just wipe and you know,
your brain has to work on knowing how to fix, because even people can move on you and then, you know, you'll have a mess up because somebody moved or jerked on you. So you have to know how to fix anything on the fly. So
it's like playing with a guitar player who can't tune his guitar. So you the song and be like, "Bro, like, come on, like, if I'm doing this, you can do it."
Right. We're going to play your newest song. It's called Foundations. But before we do, I do want to remind everyone out there, since we're on the subject, this episode is brought to you by Ink Nation, a tattoo festival, tattoo convention, February 2024, the 23rd to the 25th, here in Oklahoma City, hosted by myself and Dawn.
And it is a rocking tattoo
convention. Evan's Blue coming. We got all kinds of bands that are going to be playing acoustic performances at the convention. But let's get to the song Foundations right now by the band's Unveil the Strength. Let's go. Show, and the reason why I like doing this is we went from Taylor Swift to hip hop, playing some punk rock, then we've been back into metal music, and so we, you know, we hit all, well, I would say the biggest genres. We didn't talk about country at all, though. I do want to ask, do you guys plan on coming out with a music video for that song, or do you guys just plan on keeping it the way it is, just like that?
I would love to. You know, it's a time constraint, and for us to do videos, it's flights as well. We live in different parts of the country. So yeah, we try and do stuff like when we get back to Austin, which is our home base. Mark has a huge network of really talented people there. It's where we do most of our work. And we've done deals where we pass through, we got a day off, we pop in and record, you know, and do a video or something like that. So that's kind of the journey that we're going to have to do to finish videos for the rest of the record. The goal was to always have a video for every song, which is unrealistic, but you always set your goals high. And we have some new stuff coming out very soon. We're super excited about it. It's gorgeous. Like, it's great. It's, you'll see.
Yeah, this is actually the first song we've released without a visual of some sort.
Yeah. Okay.
And some of that's budget, some of that's timing. Like Matt said, to reinforce that, like, ideally we're in such a visual world, right? People want to see what you're doing. It's no longer listen. It's, well, what's the art with the music, what's the message being conveyed. And I don't know. I wish we could have made a video. I truly do. It's such an amazing tune. It's very
powerful. Have you guys heard of the stuff called AI and green screen? It's amazing. It's amazing.
Yeah, but why do that? But why do that? Why? It's like eating soiling cream.
Because you have a visual. You have a visual. I'm not gonna sit here and lie about it. And
cheating.
Ronnie just did it. It just got a whole bunch of stuff.
No, I'm actually a big fan of AI. It's actually something I want to explore later and in the future. But just right now, there's still a little bit of a learning curve with it. And I don't think it's quite there. And I'm kind of waiting for some of these video guys to get better at it.
It's almost over that cusp. I know what you're saying.
I agree.
Yeah,
as soon as that happens, that's absolutely something I want to take advantage of. Like, I bought a green screen. Matt has a green screen. It's certainly not anything we don't have on the table. We've actually been talking about it a lot. But for this, shots fired, rounds downrange, song's already out.
Yeah, so, I say, you know, you guys come to our tattoo convention and shoot the music video there. Yeah, that's what I recommend. That's what I recommend you guys. What'd he say?
As long as I can work.
Oh, yeah. There. Yeah, you got to work, too. Yeah, you got to work there also. Yeah, you got to work there. We'll get you a booth if you come on, and we're doing acoustic music only. But anyways, I think even without a video, the song speaks for itself. Great song, great recording. You guys sound good. Never mind about Don saying I don't like Five Finger Death Punch. That's between me and Five Finger Death Punch.
Hey,
and
God. Bro, I don't God. Like him either.
No one in this conversation is a fan of that band.
So. Okay,
I've never been a fan.
I don't know why. I just am like, it's okay. It's all right. I don't know. I'm not sold on it because I know there's still millions of albums, one of the best metal bands in the world. But to me, it's fine.
You probably have a good relationship with your parents.
Yeah. I did have a good relationship with my parents. Yeah.
Lies. That's a big lie right there. Big
not lie. A lie. Ooh, my mom's gonna kick your butt, dude.
Well, let me ask you a question. Do you have drywall issues?
Drywall, like
walls? No.
Do you have drywall issues? Like, do you punch drywall?
No.
Then that band's not for you.
I knew where he was going with that. Hold on. Well, I only have one of their songs on my playlist, and that's just because of the lyrics. I relate to them. It's not because of anything else. I would never go see them live or anything like that. I wouldn't say I'm a fan. It's just literally the lyrics.
You wouldn't see Unveil The Strength live or
Five Finger Live? Yeah, of course I would see them.
I'm talking about I wouldn't see Five Finger live.
Tattoo convention. We're going to see them. Okay.
That's right.
Let's get your website and where people can buy your merch before we get out of here.
UnveilTheStrength.com. Just go to our store. There's merch available right now. Come catch us on tour, and we'll have a different set of merch available at the show. We also, during COVID, what we did do is we did release a couple of limited edition coffees. And in the future, there will be more coffees, an unstoppable Costa Rican blend.
Ooh, you got decaf?
And a war inside us all.
Yeah. Me too.
A war inside us all, dark roast.
That so, is so cool. That
hey, nice. if you scan this little code right here, it'll actually take you to our music. So
no, I thought it was ahead. It's marked only.
Probably have exclusively available at shows, but there's two more coffees we want to release. Probably
when's your tour?
Yeah, when's your tour?
Ooh, I don't know if we can say anything.
We're leaving in 2.5 weeks. We're not allowed to announce because. We're the support.
You can't say where we're going or what we're doing.
Shut that. I'm sorry. That's just a bunch of bullshit right there. Two and a half weeks, and you can't announce it. And you leave in 2.5 weeks. You know, and I know that's you're way behind promo time for that.
You think? Yeah, I got the routing with
that won't let you announce that you leave in 2.5 weeks.
I got
weeks.
The routing today. All I can tell you is we start on October 22nd in Little Rock, Arkansas.
Okay. There
well,
you
if
go.
You find your way around Oklahoma, let me know and I will be
no
there.
They're not going to come through Oklahoma. No one goes through Oklahoma.
I have to put it out there just in case.
That's true.
You don't understand as booking agents in Oklahoma. It's a hard place and no one picks up the phone.
Okay.
Or the
well, close to Oklahoma. I may drive. Just depends. Tulsa.
Arkansas,
is it Arkansas? Dallas close. You can also check out www.ink-nation.com if you're interested in the tattoo convention. If you're interested in getting a tattoo, tattedbydawn.com is where you want to go to visit her. And you know what, since we're on that subject, Matt, go ahead and name your shop where it's located. Oh, and he
froze. My shop is My Religion Tattoo. Yeah, My Religion Tattoo in Reno, Nevada, in Midtown next to Noble Pie Pizza. Everyone in town knows
it. There you
go.
Nice. All right.
Yeah, can't miss us. We have an app for every seat. Yeah.
You guys, please stay right there till after the outro song plays. I do want to thank everyone that listens to The Loud Spot. We're on all audio platforms. And our website is, what is our website? TheLoudSpot.com?
.net.
LoudSpot.net.
You do have the .com.
I have loudspot.com. That's a whole other story because Sam screwed something up. So you have loudspot.com or the loudspot.net. That's all the time we got today. Stay out there till after the outro song plays. Please, peace out, rock on, and much love.
This is the Loud Spot outro by nothing short of tragic. Is this all talk with no action?
No.
Is this my thoughts with distraction?
No.
Is this what I bought that's in fashion? Or is this the Loud Spot with Sebastian?
Yes.
Does nothing short of tragic have us back again?
Yes.
Does everything that's good really have to end?
Yes.
A pimp host has a pimp show, so to get more episodes, make an order, this is over.